Hi everyone, it's Sue at Fiona's Fabrics in Woodbridge. Today I'm going to show you how to make this very simple tic-tac-toe or noughts and crosses fabric, playmat. I'm going to put some kits together for this and I'm trying to think of ideas of things that beginners can make which are simple to do at home. So what I would say is choose a weighty fabric. I've used the denim here, and make it as jazzy, bright, whatever as you like. The X's and O's are all done with felt, but you could use buttons, bits of Lego, whatever. So just a selection of fabrics. Now what I've got here is I've got an upholstery fabric, I've got a denim, and I've got a firm calico, so it's a heavyweight. Have a look at what looks good with them. And again, we're going to put some kits together with these. Just jazz up your colours and just choose whatever you like. So just a few ideas. Tartan looks particularly good. So we've just using ribbons that we've got in the shop, and these ribbons are all roughly about an inch across. So let's get started. The first thing we've done, we've cut a piece of fabric which is big enough for the design. Now you can scale this up if you like. This piece of fabric allows for the crosses, and what we've done on this one is we've allowed for 6-inch centres between all of the pieces of ribbon or tape. So taking that in mind, we've got 3 gaps of 6 inches. We've got 2 runs of tape which are 1 inch each, so that's 20 inches, but we do need to allow for a seam allowance, so if you allow an extra inch for your seam allowances. So this piece has been cut at 21 inches square. When you've got your pieces, and try and make sure that they are square because it'll make your sewing a lot easier. If you do have the quilter's ruler, they're great for this, and I'm going to use the ever trusty Frixion pen, or you can use an air erasable, you can use tailor's chalk, whatever. Now I need to get this squared onto this fabric so I know exactly where I'm going to put my ribbons. The first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to take a line along one edge and I'm going to mark a half an inch, because I'm marking in where my seam's going to go. So if you've not used these rulers before, they're great. So what I've got here is the edge of the ruler, I've gone half an inch into the edge of my fabric, making sure it's lined up all the way. Now I'm drawing this on the correct side of the fabric, so if you've got a dark fabric, then use a chalk or a lighter pen. So I've just got one line here, which is my half inch seam allowance. Now I need 6 inches to where my ribbon's going to go. So I'm now going to line my ruler up. Now this is a 6-inch ribbon, so it depends on what ruler you've got. So I'm making sure it's square along the edge of the fabric, that the measurement sits nice and square and it's lined up down this side. And I'm going to draw my 6-inch mark. So this is where my first line of tape is going to go. I'll just use a bit of tape just to show you. So my first line will be there. Now it's going to be an inch over, so I can carry on marking lines, but the easiest way is to flip it around the opposite side and do exactly the same process over again. Otherwise you end up marking in lines that you don't necessarily need. So for instance, that 1 inch for your tape. So again, I'm marked to a half an inch seam allowance. Coming over for my 6-inch mark, making sure I'm nice and square, and my 6-inch mark there. So do that to all 4 sides, and then you've gridded up your fabric. And if you take the time to do this, it will make your job of sewing so much easier. So my seam allowance now is all the way around 3 sides. I'm lining up my 6-inch mark across. And again, if you don't have these rulers, you can just use a tape measure and mark in, and then draw a line together with an ordinary ruler. But that's where these rulers really come into their own for doing this type of thing. So again, my half inch seam allowance, and then I'm coming in to my 6-inch mark. So I've got it lined up on the line where my seam allowance was, and I'm lining it 6 inches here. So if I'm correct, I should have half an inch either end. I should then have 2 at 6 inches, and this middle section should be 8 inches. So let's just check that. There we go, 8 inches. So you know you've got it all gridded out correctly. Next thing you're going to do is you're going to apply your ribbons. And you'll get, in the kits, you'll get 2 meters of ribbon because it's at 4 20-inch lengths. So starting again from one edge, I know that the edge of my ribbon needs to be 6 inches. So I'm going to line that up, and I'm going to pin it in place. But again, if you're a bit worried about it moving, you can go back to your trusty glue stick And remember, when you put this on, to put it on the correct side of the 6 inch. So keep measuring all the while you're doing this. And I'm lining up where my pen mark is and just coming over. And don't forget, these marks will all just iron out later. So my first line of tape is adhered. Okay. Second line of tape. And again, if you're not sure about this, measure, because we should have 7 inches, which we have 7 inches. So we know that our ribbon this side needs to be put on the inside of this one facing the other ribbon. So again, there. So let's get that marked. Don't use too much glue because we don't want to tacky up our sewing machine needles. And again, you could pin this if you can hold it in place. Make sure it's all sitting nicely. So what you're going to do now is you're going to go to your sewing machine and you're going to stitch down each side of this ribbon. You can use a slightly longer stitch than you would normally, and I would also tone your thread to the colour of whatever ribbon you're using. So I've pre-done these ones, and now we're looking at our second line. So the ribbon's going to come, that's my ribbon, whoop, that's one in the bin. So again, I'm going to just roughly measure my ribbon to get it in place. I'm going to check my measurement where I'm coming from 6. So I know that's the start, the line here is the start of my ribbon, so it goes to the right hand side of this line, and I'm going straight over the top of the previous ribbons we put on. And again, line it up, and if you get one end adhered, get your hand on it and put a little bit of tension, you'll get a nice straight line, and then you can just anchor it all down. So again, the second one, we've got a 6 inch, so it knows we come into the inside of this line here again. I'm just going to roughly cut this to the right length rather than use it from the reel. So the inside all the way up. And so I'm not using much glue on this, just a tiny bit. Getting that lined up on that line. Bit of gunk underneath there. So we've got that nice crisscross now. Right, so we're now at the sewing machine. I'll just get these ones stitched in. So, as I say, you're on your sewing machine, straight stitch. We're going to use a matching thread. Hopefully you'll be able to see me working on this one, that angle. And I'm going to use a slightly bigger stitch than normal. And this is a good practice of you getting your eye in to where you're stitching on a sewing machine. So I'm just doing straight stitch. Now there's no need to lock this off because the outer edge is going to be stitched within a seam. I'll try and keep my hands out of the way for you. And I'm just following the edge of that ribbon. Now these are quite weighty fabrics because we want to use them as a little mat, so I've been using upholstery fabrics and denims. You could use a cotton, but I think a cotton might be a bit flimsy. So what I'd advise is you put some wadding or interfacing in if you want to use cottons. Let's just whiz along these a bit. At the end, I don't need to take it off. I can put my needle in, pivot, come across the end of that ribbon. Now as you turn, if you roll this end, don't forget we haven't got a lot of space here, so if we roll it, we've got a nice level bit and a nice easy bit to push through, as opposed to it all jumbled up. Now this is a good challenge to yourself to get close to the edge of that ribbon. I'm sort of coming in a bit more than I would normally, because I want to get through this quickly for you. But again, just take your time at home and just see how close you can get. And it's good practice for your sewing. Right, so that one can come off. I'm just going to stitch the second piece, and we're nearly there. So these come together really quickly. I think it takes longer to cut out your X's and O's. And with the kits, we put a sheet in with a template for those. But as I say, you can use buttons or just print your own off. I suppose you could just glue these on, but actually we're sewers, so we don't like to glue things when we can stitch them. we get back to evening class at the shop, we want to make sure that everybody's been practicing. So again, whipping across the end, rolling my work up so it's easier to get through the throat of the machine, and then coming back down. These are really quick and easy to make, so if you're doing anything for primary schools, especially for fundraisers and things, that they come together really quickly. So I'm just going to tidy up my ribbons while I put the little bit of excess on. So just snip those down so you're working nice and even, nice and neat. So that's the front of the mat done. Now we have to work on the back. So you need a second piece of fabric, which I've just been sat on. I'm going to whip these off. Actually, I'll just take one from inside the table. Excuse me leaning over. Now, I'm going to mark this one again because I need to mark my seam allowances. Because we're all regular at the front in uniform, these two pieces of fabric have been cut out exactly the same. So to make it easier, I'm going back. And if you're good at following seam allowances, great. But this just makes that a little bit easier. So again, I'm marking my half inch lines, but this is on the back of the fabric this time because I want to use this as a stitch guide. Now I'm going to round these corners. You could keep square corners, but actually on the mats, they look quite nice to have a rounded corner. And again, it's something else to show you as you're making things. So mark all four, make sure they're all lined up on your half inch mark. And again, I'm using an air-erasable or heat-erasable pen. Now, I want to put in some nice rounded corners. So what I like to do is I take my ribbon reel, or you can use a saucer, a cup, a jar lid, and I'm making sure that the edges line up with the two sides. And I'm going to draw just an arc between the two. So if you can see that, so you need to do that on all four corners. So line it up. This is a really simple way of doing round corners. And if you use the same thing for each one, you know that they will marry up and they will all be the same. Okay, now back to our piece where we've stitched the ribbons on. So that piece with the right sides facing you, our piece we've just marked with the right sides facing down. And what we're going to do, we're going to marry up these corners and make sure it's all lined up. Now these are cut out as a pair, so they should all marry up. So I'm going to pin, making sure I'm lined up. Think about when you're pinning, if you put the pins in as you're going to put the whatever you're making to the sewing machine, the pin head should always be towards you. That way the pin is easier for you to take out. And again, as I'm going around, I'm just making sure that everything's marrying up, because what we're going to do is we're going to stitch around and then turn it through. Now we've got to turn this through, so what we have to do along one side, we have to leave a turning gap. So what I'm going to do here, and again a good rule of thumb, is to put your hand on. So you need about 3 to 4 inches, leave slightly more if you're a bit nervous. So put your hand on, try and get it in the camera, put your hand on and put a pin either side. That's a really good rule of thumb to stop you missing your gap, and put your pins at opposite angles, then you won't forget. So this is going to be my turn through piece. So again, back to the sewing machine. Now I am going to put my machine stitch back to a standard stitch length. And again, what I'm going to do now, I've got my line where I marked my seam, that is going to be my stitch line. So this one we do need to back tack. This we're going to be turning through this point. And I'm actually stitching on the line. So if I whiz around, just a point about these corners, don't trim these corners down yet. It's easier to stitch them and follow that curve around. It's a nice wide curve, so you should be great on that as a beginner. It's not a tight corner, so you don't need to put your foot down and put your needle down and lift your foot. So again, just whiz along that line, and it's easier to follow a line if you draw it rather than trying to follow the tiny markings on your base plate. I don't know if you can see on camera, but as I approach a pin, the pin head is always towards me. And that's just a good working practice to get to, because then I can just pull the pin like that. Whereas if it was the opposite way, I'd be trying to get in to pull it the opposite way. Again, around this corner, just take your time around the corner. You'll be fine. And then this down the side. Now put as many pins in as you like. These weightier fabrics do hold together quite nicely, so it's not too much of an issue. But if you are using a lighter cotton weight fabric, you might need a few more pins in. Make sure it's all sitting correctly, especially if you're not got too many pins in. Again, ease it around that corner. Reposition to come down the side. I did think that actually quite nice to make a small drawstring bag to go with these, because then you can keep everything together, like your noughts and crosses that go with it. And again, make a lovely little gift for Christmas for, you know, kids, grandkids, nieces, nephews, all that sort of thing. So if you ever stuck and you want to make little gifts. I run a community craft group locally, and we have a coffee morning every Christmas. So I'm always looking for things that we can make quite simply, which will give nice Christmas presents. That's why I'm full of ideas. So we're almost back to the start again now. So, pin out. Right, I'm leaving my gap, so I'm locking it off. So take it off your machine, snip your threads. So we're stitched all the way around except for our little turning gap here. Now we've got to now trim these seams. On the bits you've curved, we're going to go in and we're going to trim down probably to about 1/4 inch. So 0.5 centimetre if you're metric. And I will just trim down along the main seams. Just so it's all uniform, I can feel where I've got a ribbon underneath. And again, around this one. Now, so some of you are probably thinking, well, why did she leave such a big seam allowance and then trim it down? It just gives you a bit more leeway when you're stitching. And also because I wanted to do these corners, it helps with the corners. I'm gonna take these other pins out as I get to them. Having that marked line helps you enormously as a beginner, because if you're trying to follow a mark on the machine, this just gives you a definite to follow. So again, round this one. My scissors are getting blunt because I've been doing so much. These side seams, it wouldn't matter if you didn't trim these down. It's the corners that are the most important bit. Now we have to do one more process to these corners, which I'm nearly there, so. Just do this one last side. And I know these aren't ever so even, you can take a little bit more time. So where we've got the corner here, we've got this excess on the outside of the curve, which has got to go to the inside. But it's got to meet. Now there's more on the outside curve, so to be able to make it sit flat on the inside when we turn it through, we have to snip. And this is what, on dress patterns, you'll get snip and you'll get notches and snips. Now I like to fold it in half and work from the stitched piece, and I've just taken out a little notch. And again, I'm turning over and I'm taking out a little notch, and you can see, now I probably suggest about a centimetre apart or half an inch apart, something like that, all around that curved edge. Now if you do happen to snip your stitching, don't worry about it, go back to the sewing machine and just restitch that little piece. So you can see here, I've got these notches, and you can see on the camera there. And what happens if you, when we go to the inside, they will close up, so they'll make that seam look sit far flatter and nicer. So I'm just going to quickly do the other ones, and then we'll get this turned through. And all these little processes do help you in all your sewing. So this crosses over between dressmaking, crafting, and everything. So all four corners. Get these ready in advance, but I'd have that many part made samples ready for doing these tutorials that my house I think would be full. So we've got lots of little bits here, let's get those in the bin. So we're snipped, we're trimmed, and now we have to just find our opening. So pop your hand in the opening, and as ever, we're not going to turn from the opening gap. You go in and look for the furthest corner and bring that through, and then feed everything through. And this is where you challenge yourself that you've left a big enough gap. It is a challenge with me. I like to go as small because it's less to stitch up later. Okay, it will come through, just take your time. So get your hand inside, push these corners out. All of those corners, and you can see how those corners are sitting nicely with their lovely curved shape. Okay, get my hand out, this one back out. So you can see now we've got the rough shape. Now I'm going to stop, and then I'm going to press this and then come back and we'll finish off. Just a little tip, when you press these corners, when I press it will get rid of my marks from my lines. You can see I'm just slightly out there, but it's not an issue. If you press these open, just that little bit, then you won't have this gully. And I don't know if you can see on camera, it creates a little gully down here, and it's easier. What we're looking to do is to get that seam on the very edge of our mat. And if you press it open, it's easier to get that seam pressed there. So I'll be back in a short while. So we're all pressed up. So what I've done is I've made sure I've got the front nice and flat. I've taken my time and I've pressed these lovely rounded corners that we've got here. Now this is my opening here. So I've made sure that it's all lining up nicely. And what I will do is I'm going to put a pin in there, because that is the bit I turned it through, so it's not actually connected to the back. I'm going to make sure that's lined up and pop a couple of pins across, because if anything's going to move, that bit is, because it's not anchored to the back. Now, if you feel happier pinning it all around, do so, but if you give it a good press, you shouldn't need to. So I'm going to start, I'm not starting on a corner, I'm going to start just down from a corner. And again, I've got my thread to match my base fabric. I'm going to increase my stitch length to about a 3, because this is just holding it all together. And I'm just going to top stitch. Now, come into where you feel you're happy with this one, and make sure you've got to close this turning gap, so you don't want to be in too far, because you need this sealed at the edge. So all we're going to do now is we're going to stitch around the outside. So no need to lock this on, but do take a bit more attention where we've got the pins, because this is going to be closing that turning gap. So whatever width you need to come away from that outside edge, try and keep it uniform all the way around, and that's about you getting your eye in to the gap where you're needle is stitching and keeping that uniform as you go around. Take a bit more time around those corners. You could slip stitch the turning gap by hand and then not bother doing the top stitching, but who doesn't like a bit of top stitching? And again, it's all practice with your stitching. Where I started. Back to where we started, so we're now going to lock it off. Okay. Let's take it off the machine, snip and tidy up our threads. So what we've got now, we've got our basic mat, and the next phase is you need to print off noughts and crosses. You need 5 of each, and again, if you buy our kits, you'll get the template for these. If not, just go online and download an image or play around with bits and pieces. I think it's a lovely little play mat for kids. It's great for tiny ones. You can scrunch it in a bag, take it to the beach, take it to the park. It's a really simple little make, and it'd be great for fundraisers. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again soon.
Hi guys, my name's William, and this is Jack, and I'm 11, he's 5, and today we're going to teach you how to play noughts and crosses. Oh.